Good morning. Welcome to Crossroads Baptist Church. I'm so glad you joined us today. This is the day the Lord hath made, and we will rejoice and be glad in it. I'm so glad to see the weather's warming up. Things are starting to bloom up here in New England, and it's been a beautiful last few days. And I'm looking ahead to the weather. Some clouds and things maybe are around us. We got a couple cool days, but then things are just looking nice and in the 70s, and it is a great thing to behold. I want to say thank you for joining us today. And if this is your first time that you've joined us, welcome. Thank you for taking time out of your morning to join us online today. And I want to invite you to just take a moment and fill out one of the digital connection cards. There should be links in whatever platform you're watching on. And just fill out whatever information you're comfortable with so we can have a record of your visit with us this morning. And then also, if there's anything that you'd like us to follow up with, maybe you have a prayer request or a need, just let us know in those connection cards as well. And if you have already filled one out, but you have something else you'd like to share with us, go ahead and do that as well. I get them directly. And now we want to be able to take care of that any way we can and any needs you may have today. Well, thank you again for joining us. We're looking forward to wrapping up our sermon series on victory and living a victorious life. And we'll be in Matthew chapter 4 today in just a few moments. But we're going to sing a few songs together and I encourage you, wherever you're at, to sing as a family, to sing with your friends, wherever you may be today. And let's worship the Lord together. But before we do any of that, I want you to pause right where you're at, and let's go ahead and ask the Lord's blessing upon our time together this morning. So we'll pray, and then we'll sing together, and then we'll come back for a message from God's Word this morning. All right, let's have a bow our heads in a word of prayer, shall we? Heavenly Father, I thank you today for your love. Lord, we thank you for who you are. We thank you, Lord, for the opportunity we have to worship you. And dear God, I pray that you would take away any of the distractions of the day. Lord, I pray that you would guide us and direct us in this hour. Lord, may our lives line up with what our mouths speak. Lord, may our testimonies be right before you. Dear God, search our hearts. We're sinful people. Lord, may our may you search us and awaken us to any sin that may be in our lives, and we may repent and get right with thee. Lord, may there be nothing between our soul and the Savior today. Lord, as we look at your word in just a few minutes, guide our thoughts, guide our minds, we pray. As we sing unto thee, may you be honored and glorified. And we ask your blessing upon our time together. We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen.
Masterful and bright, that givest man both warmth. the earth who day by day unfoldest blessings on our way. Oh, praise Him, alleluia. The flowers and fruits that in thee grow, let them His glory also show.
He will hold me fast. Those he saves are his delight. Christ will hold me fast, precious in his holy sight. He will hold me fast. He'll not let my soul be lost. His promises shall last.
Thank you for singing with us this morning. I hope you enjoyed singing unto the Lord today. And we are now in our time for the preaching of God's Word. I encourage you to take your Bible or tablet or whatever you may have. And follow along with us in the Word of God today. We are concluding our series on victory. Now, long before any of these things happened, the Lord had led me. We consecutively preach through books of the Bible. That's just how we do it here at our church for the most part. But the Lord led me, leading up, looking ahead to Easter and looking ahead to maybe guests that may come in and just trying to, you know, the Lord led us to go a slightly different route for 6 weeks. And this was long before any of the stay-at-home orders or any of the pandemic was known. So we announced to our church we're going to have a series on victory. We're going to start off with Easter Sunday and how Jesus was victorious over the grave. And some of you have been with us the entire time. Church, you've been with us the entire time. But now we've come to our sixth message and our sixth and final one. Beginning next week, we'll be back in our study in the book of Acts. And we're in Acts chapter 15. So, church, if you want to go ahead and read through again, maybe the book of Acts this week, especially the second half, and that way we can be all on the same page as we meet back together next week. But for today, we're going to conclude our series on victory. And as I was preparing the messages for this series and praying and asking the Lord direction, there were several things, different ways we could have gone. I knew we were going to start with Jesus being our ultimate victor and being our example as he conquered death, hell, and the grave and gave us an example of his victorious resurrection. I knew we were going to start. And I knew we were going to look at how faith in him can give us a victory in our lives. And then I was laying out and thinking through some different areas where we could have victory in our lives and different things that affect us and different practical helps to all of us. Truth be told, as we went along, some of these topics were not necessarily areas where I was assuming we were going to be in 2 months ago. I really didn't think I'd be preaching a message on having victory over loneliness. I didn't know if I'd be preaching on victory over bitterness. Probably bitterness is one of these subject matters. But the Lord has seemingly brought together some of these messages for this very time. Some of them are things I've been struggling with. Truth is, there's been times I've struggled with loneliness. Our families together, and I love my family and our girls, we have a great time at the house. But being alone and asking the Lord why, at times we all struggle with loneliness. And that message was a personal help to me. There's been times where we here in Massachusetts have some of the more, the stricter orders and have some of the higher counts of the cases of this COVID-19. And other places and other states have been wide open for a while. They never had such strict orders. I have family that's at the beach this coming week. And so it can easily be, it can be easy to get bitter. So the Lord used that for me as well. I needed that reminder. And then also, all of that kind of culminates in today's message. No matter whether we're stuck at home or whether we're out doing our regular routine, this message will be I'm not going to say it's going to be an encouragement to us, but it will be a help to us wherever we may be. And the last message in our series on being victory is on having victory is overcoming temptation. Overcoming temptation. Now, the aspect of what some of these temptations may be in our lives can shift, whether we're at the beach or whether we're at work or whether we're sitting at home. There's been many temptations in my own life that I've had to ask the Lord to help me with. There may be the temptation to loneliness, the temptation to bitterness, the temptation to fear. But today we're going to look at how the Lord Jesus Christ conquered the temptation of the devil. You know, we're in a real battle. We are in a battle in our lives today. Not a battle with other people, but in a spiritual battle. And it's real. And we have a real enemy. We have a real foe. The very premise of this series on victory says in order to have victory, there has to be something, a confrontation, in order to have victory over anything. So in the midst of the battle that we may gain victory in, we have an enemy. We have an adversary. The Bible calls it, we have an adversary, the devil, and he is a roaring lion, walketh about seeking whom he may devour. And so we have an enemy who's just desiring to get us to fall. And he gets us to fall through temptation. Oftentimes in the Bible we hear the terms testing and trial and temptation. We often think they're all the same. They're not. Testings and trials are things that perhaps the Lord brings into our lives to refine us. That the lump of metal that's put into the fire to refine it, to get rid of the impurities. It's a painful process, it's a burning process, but it's a process that would bring it forth as pure gold. So sometimes the Lord puts us through trials and puts us through difficult times and testings to try and bring us about the beautiful picture that He desires for us to be. That may not always be easy. The very idea of a trial and a test is difficult. But one thing the Lord does not do is tempt us. The Bible tells us that He does not tempt us with evil, and He doesn't tempt any man. Because to draw one away and to sin is sin itself. And the Lord will never tempt us. Yet, the devil desires to tempt us to get us to sin so frequently. So temptation, though, to all of us may be different. The devil and his demons have studied us. They studied you. They know what gets you. The devil's not as foolish as some of us want to think. He's cunning. He's intelligent. and he uses his minions and he uses his ability to specialize a form of temptation for you and for me. What gets us to sin, what gets you to sin may not be what is the area of my weakest link, if you will. I remember when I was in probably middle school. I don't remember, maybe middle school, high school. Actually, it was probably high school because I think I got in my own car. One thing that we were always taught as teenagers in high school and in youth group and growing up in church was to be careful what kind of music we listen to. Purpose of the message today is not to tell you what is right, what is wrong as far as a musical styling. I'm not going to get into that right now. That's not the time nor the place. But we were warned so often, you know, be careful. Music can influence you, which is the truth. Music does influence us. Music affects our mood. Music affects so many things. Music's important. So we were told to be careful what we listened to and what we allowed in. And to me, I love music today, and the Lord has built has grown a love for music in my life. And maybe that's being married to Michelle, who loves music as well and plays and sings and things. But even before that, I love to sing. I can't, but I love to. But when I was younger, music wasn't a huge deal to me. It just wasn't. But yet we are harped on so often, you know, be careful what you listen to. Be careful the evils of music at times. I remember sitting in my car, turning on the local rock station, and trying to listen. And just after a few minutes, shutting it off and almost crying, said, why does this not tempt me? Why am I not controlled by this? It wasn't an area of temptation the devil was going to use in my life, because for whatever reason at the time, I'm not going to say I was beyond it, it had no effect on me, but it wasn't anything I was interested in. It just wasn't. Now, there were other areas of my life where somebody else could have had the same thing and said, why are you, you know, what's that such a big deal to you? But to me, it was a strong temptation. Food is a strong temptation for me. I would be have to be aware of being gluttonous at times. I love food. Food itself is not a sin, obviously. But we often say that we're tempted by food. Because what can be a sin is overeating. And gluttony. And not taking care of ourselves. That's an area that I'm very much tempted in. So each of us, though, have different things that tempt us. All temptations, though, have been, it's said they can kind of fall into three different categories. We're tempted in the pride of life, the lust of the flesh, and the lust of the eyes. The Bible talks about those different areas. And in fact, in our passage this morning, which if you want to turn to Matthew chapter number 4, our passage this morning deals with the temptation of the Lord Jesus Christ, and it deals with how he's tempted in these different areas. So just a few minutes, we're going to read Matthew chapter number 4. But the reason we're in this passage is because we're speaking about not just temptations and what they look like, but we're really, the focus of our message today is how that we can be victorious over temptation. As you're sitting at home, not going through your normal routine, there's maybe some new temptations. You know, each of us, while on this earth, we're made of this flesh, and this flesh desires to do what it wants to do. A temptation is something that we desire for ourselves that is not what God desires for us to partake in. It may be straight up sinful, and he may tempt us towards things that are just not what, the devil may tempt us towards areas that are not what God's will is for our lives in that time, in that place. And so we must be careful. Matthew chapter 4 today, we're going to look at this passage and look at, again, back to square one, as Jesus is our ultimate example. And you know what? This kind of encourages me as well. That we serve a God, a Savior, who died for us, who was tempted just like we are, yet the Bible says without sin. The devil tried to tempt him. And I think if the devil's trying to tempt the Savior, he's certainly going to try and tempt us. So let's look at this passage this morning and see what we can apply to our lives and how this can be an encouragement, maybe not encouragement, but a help to us as we live, that we can be victorious and we can overcome temptation. Now, before we ever begin, we may not pass every test. We're not. We will fail. Jesus didn't. That's why he's our Savior. But we fail, and we will fail. But I want to encourage you, though, that he has laid out a way that we can be victorious over the war. We may lose a battle here and there, but get right back up and let's follow this example of how we can be victorious over in the war ultimately. All right. Matthew chapter 4, beginning verse number 1. Then was Jesus led up of the Spirit into the wilderness to be tempted of the devil. And when he had fasted 40 days and 40 nights, he was afterward and hungered. And when the tempter came to him, he said, If thou be the Son of God, command that these stones be made bread. And when he answered and said, It is written, Man shall not live by bread alone, but by every word that proceedeth out of the mouth of God. Then the devil taketh him up into the holy city, and setteth him on a pinnacle of the temple, and saith unto him, If thou be the Son of God, cast thyself down, for it is written, He shall give his angels charge concerning thee, and in their hands they shall bear thee up, lest at any time thou dash thy foot against a stone. Jesus said unto him, It is written again, Thou shalt not tempt the Lord thy God. Again, the devil taketh him up into an exceeding high mountain, and showeth him all the kingdoms of the world, and the glory of them. And he saith unto him, All these things will I give thee, if thou wilt fall down and worship me. Then saith Jesus unto him, Get thee hence, Satan, for it is written, Thou shalt worship the Lord thy God, and him only shalt thou serve. Then the devil leaveth him, and behold, angels came, and ministered unto him. Here in this passage, we see the three different areas of temptation that the Lord was tempted in, and that the same areas that the devil tries to tempt each and every one of us in. Now, this may look different for all of us, but we see in the first temptation, he's hungry. He's physically exhausted, and he is hungry, and the devil tempts him with something that would fulfill his flesh. The lust of the flesh, the desire to have nourishment. This is a temptation we can quantify as a lust of the flesh. It was an immediate fulfillment. The next temptation was that he was going to bring him up to a high place and throw himself down, and then the angels would come and take care of him. This could be a pride of life temptation, because he was it could elevate him to the place to where, man, it feels good to know that there's many others that will care for me. That's a prideful uplifting. The last one was when he was fall down, if he were to fall down and worship the devil would give him everything his eyes could see. His eyes, the lust of the eyes. And desiring to have that which you see and is before you. So in every area that we may be tempted of, Jesus gave an illustration, gave an example of how we can defeat it and how we can be victorious in our own lives. I'm thankful that we have a high priest that is touched with the feelings of our infirmities, and yet he's tempted like as we are, yet without sin. So what can we learn this morning from this temptation and how we can be victorious? So for the next few minutes, let's look at this, how we can overcome temptations. Temptations, understand this, and are expected part of the Christian life. As I said earlier, the devil desires to destroy us. This should be something that is expected. Expect to be tempted. Expect for the devil to want to bring you down. First off, if you never expect to be tempted, you've probably already lost. But first off, we can be not a real outline maybe this morning, but just a challenge to us. The first way that we can help to overcome temptation is expected to happen. Be aware. The Bible tells us, be sober, be vigilant, for your adversary the devil as a roaring lion walketh about seeking whom he may devour. And if we know that he's coming, we need to be sober. We need to be vigilant. We need to be prepared for the attack of the devil, the temptation of Satan. Are we aware that as Christians we have a target on our back the devil desires to tempt us, to get us to be destroyed? Expect it. We may wish that we would get to a place in our lives where we could completely escape temptation, but we can't. We can't. You can lock yourself in a room and there will still be temptations, maybe to slothfulness and to laziness. There's no way on this earth that you can escape any and all temptation. It's not going to happen. But you can be victorious and overcome it. The Lord has allowed us and enabled us. We know this. You will not live perfectly, but you are capable of it, if that makes sense. Because He's given us an example to follow. And He's enabled us to overcome temptation. God has designed our lives. He has not designed the temptation, but designed times in our lives to bring us, to equip us to be prepared for the temptations. And understand this. Enticements and temptations to sin do not come from God. And we see that. James chapter number 1. I've got to be careful. This is a page in my Bible, not James, but here in Matthew that I'm about tore it up. Hebrews, James. Didn't mark it. I wasn't necessarily planning on turning here, but nothing like... It's one thing if you're sitting in front of me and not hearing anything, but there's nothing like dead air, huh? James chapter number 1, verse 13. Let no man say when he is tempted, I am tempted of God. Here's the exact warning. It's not even saying he doesn't do it, but here's a warning against us saying we're tempted of God. Let no man say when he's tempted, I am tempted of God. For God cannot be tempted with evil, neither tempteth he any man. But every man is tempted when he is drawn away of his own lust and enticed. And when lust hath conceived, it bringeth forth sin. And sin, when is finished, bringeth forth death. Do not err, my beloved brethren. It is the devil that seeks to capitalize on our weaknesses and move us to give in to our desires. Now, back in Matthew chapter number 4, let's look today at overcoming temptation. Notice some things. First off, understand temptations will come. You will never overcome a temptation if you're not aware that they will be there. You don't look for the temptation to seek it after, but you're aware of it when it comes because you know and you're sober and you know you have an enemy. All right? It's interesting. Sometimes temptation comes right after a spiritual high. Right after a time of great victory. Not always. But here, Jesus, he has a relationship with, he's fasting and he's praying for 40 days. He's really getting close to his Father. And that's when the temptation happens. I could think of Elijah on Mount Carmel when he had the victory over the... Elijah or Elisha? My mind just went blank because this was not in my... I'm sorry. Withstood the prophets of Baal. Fire came down from heaven. And then shortly thereafter, you see him defeated, succumbing to the temptations of the devil that he's the only one around. And his depression came in. He was physically exhausted, and the devil kept tempting him that there was no hope. Came right after that great spiritual victory. But here is a key to overcoming temptation. That has to do with the timing, but that's not really the key to overcoming it. Here's one of the keys to overcoming it. Maintain a right walk with the Lord. Maintain a relationship with the Lord. You may be tempted, but Jesus here was, for just a moment, let's time out. We know that Jesus Christ is God the Son. He is God in flesh. So he knows, he is God. But here as a man, he was able to fight the devil, having already maintained a relationship with his Father. Okay? So he desired to maintain that relationship. He desired to maintain that fellowship. Let me say that. He had no desire to turn his back on his Father. You know what, when the devil tempts us, so often if we're not maintaining a right fellowship with our Heavenly Father, right fellowship with our Savior, then when that temptation comes, we are unwilling to fight it. We are unwilling to gain victory over it because really we don't care. Because we're living for ourselves anyway, and we see that temptation as a desire to fulfill what we already want. So in order to overcome temptation, Jesus was just coming off. The timing was seemed he was a very low point physically, but he was also maintaining that fellowship with his Father. So if we're going to overcome temptation, we need to make sure that we maintain right fellowship. Otherwise, we're not equipped. We're not equipped. We're not desiring to overcome the temptation. Understand it's coming. But don't just look for the temptation. Maintain fellowship with the Savior. Maintain fellowship with the Father. So that when the temptation does come, you have A, equipped to defend against it, and B, you're desiring to defend against it. Here's a thought. You ever gotten upset at somebody? Maybe you had a friend, okay? And maybe you had a former coworker that you were buddies with. You feel that they wronged you. You've lost relationship. You lost fellowship with that person. And then somebody else comes and hurts them. We're guilty. This isn't the right, but we're also, they got what's coming to them. They deserved it. Why? If we had maintained a fellowship with that individual, we'd be in their defense because we want to stick up to our friend, for our friend. When we're tempted of the devil, we're not maintaining right fellowship with our Heavenly Father and with our Savior, then what we are, we're not willing to maintain, because the temptation in getting us to sin is not so much an attack on you personally, but it's an attack on God. It's the devil trying to say, I'm going to destroy what is God's and dirty his name. Because when a Christian falls, what that does is it hinders the name of Christ. So if we're unwilling to stand up against the devil, we're hurting the name of Jesus. And why would we hurt the name of someone else? Because we did not look for their best interest. But when that fellowship is broken, we don't care if it hurts somebody else. If we're going to overcome temptation, we must maintain right fellowship with the Savior. We spoke about how the temptations come in these three different areas of life. So how else do we overcome and are we victorious over temptation? And that's through the Word of God. So be aware that it's happening. And these are the first one is a preventative measure. Beware that it's happening. Be looking for it. Second one's a preventative measure to be victorious is maintain a fellowship with the Savior. Maintain your relationship with Christ. If you're not consistently maintaining that relationship, then you're not prepared. But then when the temptation actually comes, we must be prepared with ammunition. If you're going to overcome, how did Jesus overcome temptation? Each time the devil tempted him, he responded with Scripture. Look back, thy word have I hid in mine heart that I might not sin against God. The psalmist said, I've hid God's word in my heart that I may be prepared to give an answer, that I may be prepared to fight the devil. There are scriptures all throughout the Old and New Testament that deal with different areas of a life that you or I may be tempted in. You're tempted for things that bring before your eye gate. Maybe you're tempted by things on a computer or tempted by things on a television that you shouldn't be watching and shouldn't be putting in your eye gate. I will set no wicked thing before mine eye. I hate the work of them that turn aside. It shall not cleave to me. I don't right now. I used to have that verse. Maybe I should put it back up there just as a reminder. But in other offices I've worked, I've had that verse taped right on my computer monitor just as a reminder. I will set no wicked thing before mine eye. I hate the work of them that turn aside. It shall not cleave to me. There are other verses that maybe you're tempted to anger. Find verses that deal with anger. Maybe you're tempted to gluttony. Find verses that deal with gluttony. that you can, when that temptation comes, when that fifth plate of food was put before you, you could say, hold on, we've got to step aside here. Let me defeat this temptation. The devil knows what gets you. And so we must know ourselves where we're tempted and be prepared with the proper ammunition. Jesus, in our passage today, the devil tempted him. In verse number 4, he says, but he answered, it is written. Verse 7, he answered, it is written. Verse 10, he answered unto him, get thee hence, Satan, for it is written. Jesus had committed, he is the Word, but he had committed the Word of God to memory. If you and I are going to be victorious and overcome temptation, we must commit to memory the Word of God. The Word of God is quick and powerful and sharper than any two-edged sword, piercing even the dividing center of the soul and spirit and the joints and marrow, and is a discerner of the thoughts and intents of the heart. The Word of God is our sword. The Word of God is the tool which we will defeat the enemy. So often we fail in temptation and we succumb to temptation because we try and defeat the enemy with our own strength and our own ability and our own mindset, our own intellect, and our own will. And we will fail if we're not prepared with the ammunition of the Word of God. You want to overcome temptation? Be ready for it. Maintain fellowship with the Savior. And be prepared with the ammunition of the Word of God. This is where we really need to work on. Some people, I've heard of people that carry literally maybe a notebook in their pocket or just verses in their pocket. They've done it for memorization, but on areas where they know they're tempted. And they'll pull their, when they feel that temptation coming, whether they're in a place to look at something, they'll pull those verses out. Maybe they haven't pulled up on their phone, they can look at that. You know, the little kid, when our girls used to watch a show, I forget what it was. It's just a little kid cartoon. They said something like, when you're angry, stomp your feet, 1, 2, 3. It was a foolish reason, but they said, and then to get away from the angry so that you don't fight back. Well, maybe not that example, but that's what we need to do in our own lives, is be prepared that when we feel it coming, be able to fight back and know what it is that the devil's trying to do. I'm not going to tell you this is how you're tempted and you need to fix this in your life, and this is what the, because each and every one of us are tempted in different ways, but understand the devil is desiring to tempt us and destroy us. And when we know what's coming our way, be prepared. And you know what? This takes preparation. Sometimes we think temptation is just something that happens, right? You know, we weren't ready for the temptation, just hit me upside the head. You know, that may be the actual moment of that temptation. But we need to be prepared in how to handle anything that comes our way. We used to tell, when I was a youth director, and I used to tell teenagers all the time, be able to give the answer. Now I forgot my quote. It wasn't original with me. Be prepared to know the answer ahead of time, so that when you're in the midst of the temptation, you already know your answer. It sounded better when I said it before. Maybe if you're one of my teenagers from long ago and you're watching, let me know what I used to say. But that, so that you're not waiting to think about, make the hard decisions ahead of time. Bug. Make the hard decisions ahead of time. You know, when you're tempted in that relationship with a member of the opposite sex, know ahead of time, we're not going to allow this to happen. So that when that temptation comes, you're like, whoa, I got broadside. I didn't even think it was coming. No, know ahead of time. You're going to make that decision. When the question is put before you, when the substance of dealing with primarily teen issues, when that substance is put in front of you, are you going to consume that? Well, don't wait till the heat of the moment when your friends are all around you. Oh, no, should I or shouldn't I? No, know the decision ahead of time and be prepared to give an answer. So as an adult, as children, as teenagers, wherever you may be prepared that when that temptation does kind of broadside us, we're prepared with an answer. Jesus had the Word of God committed, and that's how he defeated the devil. He did not try and defeat him on his own. He defeated him in the power and the name of God. We will fail. God will never fail. Our strength is weak. God's Word is all-powerful. How are we going to overcome temptation today? we cause the devil to flee. Notice how what happened. Verse number 10, Matthew chapter 4. Then Jesus answered, "Get thee hence, Satan, for it is written, Thou shalt worship the Lord thy God, him only shalt thou serve." He answered him with the word of God. Verse 11, "Then the devil leaveth him, and behold, angels came and ministered unto him." Know this. The Lord is on your side. Sometimes we overcome temptation when we realize we are already equipped to do so. Nothing, this isn't like a take it out of context and say, I can do anything, but nothing that comes your way is too hard for you to handle if handled in the name of the Lord. No temptation the devil takes and brings before you are you not equipped for. Why? If you're a Christian and you have the Lord Jesus Christ and the Spirit of God within you, you have a victorious ability. And this isn't some like, oh, just jump up and down and claim the victory and do whatever you want. No. But you have Jesus on your side. And that helps us right there be victorious over temptation. And that helps us right there. It doesn't guarantee victory, because why? If we don't use our resources, then what good is it? When we try and defeat the devil on our own strength, we'll fail. So often we succumb to temptation because we want to. Not so much because we're overwhelmed, but because we're not putting in a position of maintaining that fellowship with the Lord. And we want to feed our flesh. We want to do what our desires are. But remember this, as a Christian, you've been bought with a price. You're no longer you and I, we no longer belong to ourselves. We belong to the Lord. Our lives ought to line up with His desires, not just ours. The great thing about how the Lord works, though, is when we are maintaining fellowship with Him, His desires become our desires, and He desires, using the word too often, He desires to bless us and to help us. Jesus, here, as an example, the angels came and ministered unto Him in verse number 11. I think, sure, He's the Son of God, but this is not to tell us that He got something we don't have. I think the Spirit of God desires to minister unto our hearts when we defeat temptation. Why? Because He wants... Every time we overcome temptation in the name of the Lord, it's a step closer. It's another step of victory. And the Lord God Almighty desires for us to live in that victory, to live in that communion with Him. When we resist Him in the power of God's Word, the devil flees. If we try to resist Him in our own efforts, of course, then he stays and he gains an easy victory over us. But Jesus' example here teaches us that the devil cannot stand it when we personally resist him by resorting to faith in God's Word. Sometimes we just don't believe we can be victorious over temptation. We're just going to fail every time. So that's it, we do. The Bible says in James chapter 4, verse 7, resist the devil and he will flee from you. And remember this, after temptation, this encourages us to desire victories. Because after temptation, God promises comfort. The angels came and ministered unto the Lord here himself. Some practical help today to overcoming temptation. God sustains us during this temptation. 1 Corinthians chapter 10, verse 3. That's not right. My notes. Man. God desires to help us and maintain through the temptation. 1 Corinthians chapter 10. Verse 13. That's what I thought. The Bible says, "There hath no temptation taken you, but such is as common to man, but God is faithful, who will not suffer you to be tempted above that ye are able, but will with the temptation also make a way to escape, that ye may be able to bear it. Right there, you know you're not going to go through anything that God will not allow you, temptation-wise, to get out of. Another verse, Hebrews chapter 12. Hebrews chapter 12, verse 3. For consider him that endured such contradiction of sinners against himself, lest ye be wearied and faint in your minds. The Lord's own example, I think, here in this passage is intended to encourage us, to give us strength, to give us comfort overcoming temptation. I think, though, in all of this, I'm in Hebrews chapter. Turn to Hebrews chapter 4. It's in Hebrews chapter 12 if you turn there. But Hebrews chapter 4, I think one of the greatest truths and the greatest lesson we can learn is not just about ourselves and overcoming temptation. But Hebrews chapter 4, verse 14 says this: Seeing then that we have a great high priest that is passed under the heavens, Jesus, the Son of God, let us hold fast our profession. For we have not an high priest which cannot be touched with the feeling of our infirmities, but was in all points tempted like as we are, yet without sin. Let us therefore come boldly into the throne of grace, that we may obtain mercy and find grace to help in time of need. That we may find grace to help in time of need. Hebrews chapter 2, verse 8. That thou hast put all things in subjection under his feet, for in that he put all in subjection under him, he left nothing that is not under him. But now we are not yet all things put under him. Wrong verse. I meant to read verse 18. That didn't make any sense. For in that he himself hath suffered, being tempted, he is able to succor them that are tempted. One to help us overcome temptation. Understand this: when we are tempted to disobey, when we're tempted to give into our flesh, remember this, Jesus was tempted as well. Jesus himself was tempted. When we want to gratify our flesh and our pride and to elevate ourselves over others, Jesus felt that same temptation. And he is able to help us resist. Did you ever lust after what the world has? So did Jesus didn't lust after it, but he was tempted to. And he gave us an example. Jesus understands every feeling of your temptation by his own personal experience, and he is able to strengthen you. If you want to overcome temptation and have victory over temptation in your life, you must know the Savior. You must have a relationship with Jesus Christ. He himself is our example. He himself enables us to resist temptation. If you've never had, if you've never developed a relationship with the Lord Jesus Christ, if you've never called upon him for salvation to purchase your sin debt, he's purchased it, but and claimed that satisfaction that he accomplished on the cross of Calvary, then you will fail to overcome temptation, because you will constantly be trying in your own strength. Jesus, I think one of the greatest things about this passage is that he gives us hope. Sometimes we're just so mired in dismay that we cannot overcome. Jesus did, and he gives us hope. He was tempted like we are, yet without sin. We don't have a great high priest that has not been touched with the feelings of our infirmities. He's been where you are. And yet, he showed us an example, and he desires to help us through. overcoming temptation starts with a relationship with Jesus. If you've never called upon Him as you be your personal Savior, forgive you of your sins, and by faith trust Him and Him alone, then you're just trying this whole thing on your own strength, and you will fail. And you will fail eternally. Jesus made a way. Not just temporally, earthly, a way of overcoming temptation in this passage, but He made a way of victory over sin as our Savior. And the Bible says, "For whosoever shall call upon the name of the Lord shall be saved." Even in the midst of that temptation, call upon the name of the Lord, and He'll desire to help us, and He helps us, and He guides us, and He strengthens us. But for your eternal soul, we need to call upon Him. If you've never trusted Jesus as your Savior, friend, I challenge you today. Make today the day of salvation. Christian, if you want victory over temptation, some practical truths, know what's coming. Maintain a relationship with Jesus. Load up on the ammunition of Scripture. And know that God's on your side. And He desires to help you overcome. I pray this message has been a help to us today. I won't say a great encouragement, except to know that you can overcome. If you have any needs today, let us know. If there's anything we can help you with, let us know. I'm praying for you. I hope you have a great week this week. God bless you. Let's have a word of prayer. Heavenly Father, I thank You tonight, today, for Your word. I thank You for who You are. I thank You for the example You left us that we can overcome temptation. Help us today, we pray. In Jesus' name, amen.